I think we can start. Welcome everyone to this new season of Autonomy Talks. This week is a great pleasure to have with us Professor Matthias Althoff, who is a professor in computer science at the Technical University of Munich. So something about Matthias, he received his diploma in mechatronic and information technology from the Department of Mechanical Engineering at Technical University of Munich in 2005. He then received his PhD in the same school, though in the electrical engineering department. And then he was for a while a postdoctoral researcher at Carnegie Mellon University in USA. He then was first an assistant professor at the Menao University of Technology before moving to TUM. In general, his research interests include the design and analysis of cyber-physical systems, formal verification of continuous and hybrid systems, reachability analysis, planning algorithms, and robust and fault-tolerant control. Is mainly known for his applications in automated vehicles, robotics, and power systems, and is really active in many fields with many endeavors. Today, he's going to present the work of he and his collaborators on formally correct motion planning through online verification, which seems to be a paradigm shift, as you can read from the abstract. And so we are very, very excited to hear more about the subject, and that's why I give you the stage, Matthias. Go ahead, the stage is yours.
Yeah. Thanks for your kind introduction. Thanks all for joining. It's a pleasure to give a talk. And most of you already know this example, but I gave this talk also to different audiences which don't know about this first incident where a human died in a car crash with an autonomous vehicle. This was the Uber test drive some time ago. You can see here this, there was a pedestrian crossing with a bicycle. And there were many things happening. First of all, the built-in braking assistance system was switched off. The safety driver didn't pay attention. The vehicle was overspeeding, and they couldn't classify this object, and they ignored it. And that ultimately led to the death of this person. So there are two or three more screenshots. If you don't want to see it, you can close your eyes. So this, of course, was a serious incident. There have been many other accidents with autonomous vehicles. Most of them were caused by humans, but there were also some caused by autonomous vehicles, like in Google vehicle crashing into a bus and similar incidents. Of course, the difficulty is that humans drive already quite well. So you have to drive for like 200 or 300 million miles to have a fatal accident. And the rarity of these events requires, of course, super reliable autonomous systems, especially in very unstructured environments. So as you can see here in these four examples, you have a person parking her or his vehicle on the middle of the road and walking away. This is a rare event, very hard to foresee with purely machine learning. You have people not respecting traffic rules, you have a landslide, or you have this cement truck approaching you on two wheels. And of course, it is expected by the general public that we can handle these kinds of cases at least as good as a human driver could do that. And from a statistical point of view, you have to drive like around 440 million kilometers to demonstrate that you're a better driver as an autonomous vehicle compared to a human with 95% confidence. And this requires 12 and a half years of test driving with 100 test vehicles. And of course, under the assumption that you don't change the code in the 12 and a half years, which is almost never happening, never going to happen. So this is, of course, a huge challenge. And if you look at it from kind of a test coverage perspective, then you have a lot of parameters influencing the behavior of the autonomous vehicle. I mean, the simplest ones are probably shown here in the top left, the lane width and the curvature, and maybe the change of curvature. And these would be three parameters. If you would do a full factorial test and maybe assign 12 possible values for each parameter, then you have 20 to the power of three possible possibilities already. And if you consider maybe five lanes, that is easily achieved on highways or on intersections with several merging and forking lanes. Then you have already 20 to the power of 3 to the power of 5 test cases. And of course, this explodes even further if you consider more other traffic participants, which have different X and Y position, velocity, and orientation. And of course, there's not only one other traffic participant, but many others. And then, of course, you have your own uncertainty in your ego vehicle, and then you have a huge number of scenarios which is infeasible to test before the system is deployed. There's still a lot of people advocating the scenario-based testing, and they, of course, argue, yeah, there are, we can cluster some of these scenarios, but it's still, I would say, unsolved. And for this reason, we propose this paradigm shift where we say, okay, only a very, very tiny fraction of the scenarios will be happening while the vehicle is in operation. So instead of testing everything that's possible, we want to do online verification. So we know the current surrounding of the vehicle by all the sensors it has and map information and so on. And then we just want to know whether we can reach in the next planning cycle a safe state. And we do this online verification all the time to make sure that every action that we suggest is safe for an infinite time horizon. And because this is a much smaller verification problem, this can be solved online, as I will demonstrate later. And we can always consider the current scenario. So we don't have these gaps. If you use scenario-based testing, that of course you can only test finitely many test cases. There are infinitely many possibilities due to the nature of real numbers. So there are no gaps basically in the verification problem. And of course we require this efficient and online adaptable verification procedure, but as an impact have this reduced cost due to less testing. We have fewer liability claims because we can show that every situation is considered as it is, and we can enable safe autonomy for a larger range of use cases. So the basic idea is very simple, and we have many, many extensions, but of course it makes sense to start with the simple idea. So we simply compute all possibilities of other traffic participants and of our own vehicle. Of course, because of disturbances and sensor noise, our own behavior is also not deterministic. And we do this for consecutive time intervals. And for instance, if the occupancies of different traffic participants don't intersect, then we can prove there's no collision for this finite prediction horizon. And then the question is, how can we ensure safety now for an infinite horizon? And actually, this is rather straightforward. So basically, what most motion planners do right now, they predict the movement of other traffic participants. In this case, we predict that this vehicle stays on its lane and drives maybe with constant velocity. And because this is slower than we are performing this lane change to overtake this vehicle. And then people usually hope for the best. And instead, what we do is we compute all possibilities of other traffic participants and also a fail-safe maneuver. And this fail-safe maneuver ends in a state where we can stay indefinitely long without causing any collision or without violating any traffic rules. And of course, crash can still happen. Like if you stop in a traffic jam, then somebody can rear-end you and you have no way of escaping. The only thing we can do with this approach, of course, is to ensure that we're not causing any accidents or that we don't cause any rule violations. And so in the next time step, then this vehicle actually does an unexpected lane change. And of course, the vehicle can only move within the previously computed reachable set. So the intended maneuver A plus the fail-safe maneuver B are still safe. Nevertheless, we try to find a new safe intended maneuver A prime with a new fail-safe maneuver B prime that is safe with respect to all possibilities of the other vehicle. And this repeats over and over again. And the proof why this is always working is kind of a simple induction proof. So initially the vehicle is at rest. So you enter the vehicle and only starts moving when you have A and B. And then of course, there will always be a next A and B. Otherwise you would not switch to the next intended maneuver. So this is a rather important basic concept of our approach. So if you have any questions regarding this, then now is a good time to ask a question about this.
Matthias. You call for a question. The usual thing is, what if you don't have any fail-safe trajectory?
Yeah, so we assume that the that the phase of trajectory always exists because we only switch to a next intended plan if, again, this has a verified fail-safe trajectory. There can, however, there can be one incident, for instance, let's say if a pedestrian stands next to the road and then jumps in front of in a suicidal manner in front of the ego vehicle, then of course there is no fail-safe maneuver anymore, but then we can easily show that this person violated a traffic rule and there was no way of escaping this.
And so
we try to rescue situations, but this approach only proves correctness. It only proves that we are not causing any collision.
Okay. We'll maybe pick it up later at the end of the talk.
Yeah. And we only don't only look at collision avoidance, but also at traffic rule compliance. And also, like, I have also one PhD student using your rule books to kind of say which rule is more important and to prioritize the traffic rules. And I come to traffic rules also later on in my talk.
Maybe Matthias, a question from the chat, which is, I guess it's important now. Could you briefly say what is a fail-safe trajectory for people not knowing that?
Yeah, so a fail-safe trajectory is a trajectory that branches off the intended trajectory and ends up in a state in which we can stay for all times without causing any collision or violating any traffic rules. So for instance, in an urban setting, it would be just to stop on your lane. On a highway, you cannot just stop. That would not be in line with the traffic rules. Then you have to stop maybe on the shoulder lane, or we can engage a provably safe adaptive cruise controller, which is something we also developed in the recent years. That would also be a state that would be considered safe indefinitely. Okay, right. So, as I said before, we are also considering the uncertainties of the ego vehicle, and for that we're using reachability analysis because we cannot exactly follow the planned trajectory. I didn't want to include this in the previous picture, otherwise it would be a little bit overloaded. But this is also something that is not really done a lot in industry and research right now. And so this talk will also highlight the benefits of this. Of course, this principle cannot only be applied to autonomous driving, where the unsafe regions comes from other traffic participants and the goal region comes from the planning goals. But this also can be applied, for instance, to safe human-robot coexistence, where the possible occupancy of humans would then be the unsafe regions. And also for smart grids, we use the same technology where unsafe regions would be unwanted frequency values or voltage values in the smart grid, for instance. For the smart grid, I don't have an additional video, but for human-robot coexistence, I have a video. With smart grids, it's always hard to have the visualization is not so appealing as for human-robot coexistence or autonomous driving. This slide, of course, shows an alternative approach, which would be, for instance, a probabilistic one. I always include this in my presentation because there's almost 100% guarantee that somebody asked me at the end why we use these set-based methods instead of probabilistic methods. So, of course, probabilistic methods also are good for many things. So, as you can see here, we predicted, or this was part of my PhD thesis where I predicted future occupancy of other traffic participants, and by intersecting these probability distributions in a special way, you can compute the likelihood of a crash over time. And this is good for threat assessment. Of course, with set-based methods, you can only say, yeah, safe or not safe. You cannot really do a threat assessment. And it's good for guiding long-term planners, because you want to go with the most likely situation so that your solution is rather stable and you don't have very jerky maneuvers. However, if you use these probabilistic methods, you have almost no accountability because the stochastic reasoning blurs over time because you have stochasticity starting from the sensors, then from the sensor fusion and so on up to the controller action. And that's very hard to figure out what component really didn't follows the specification. And if you use set-based techniques, and then you also have specifications on the sensors, the sensor fusion, and also the safe planning, which is part of this talk, then you can really say exactly which parts of the chain failed. And also, as I mentioned before, the rarity of the of luckily the driving is rather safe, although it's still the main cause of deaths for people under 30. But considering the amount of miles driven, for let's say a typical prediction horizon of 0.2 miles, you have probabilities in the order of 10 to the minus 9, where even rounding errors accumulate maybe to this number. And if you maybe didn't properly model this stochastic process because you modeled something as stochastic independent, which is not, you have much bigger errors than that. And for that reason, and because I think you have to be much better than a human driver so that this technology is socially accepted, we go for these rigorous methods instead of the stochastic methods. So as for any formal verification problem, we need the model, we need a specification, and we need a formal verification engine. And then we get a result that says it's provably correct or it's incorrect, plus a bug trace. Or in our case, a trajectory showing why the system is not safe. And because this is not a purely, we don't have a pure software, we have cyber physical systems, the model never really exactly matches the reality. So we have to come up with conformant models. And also the specification is non-trivial because traffic rules are written for humans and we have to concretize the traffic rules and formulate them in temporal logic so that it's machine readable. I will briefly talk about how we handle the model issue, then about the specification. Of course, we have much more work on this than I show in this presentation. And finally, how our verification engine works in principle. So as I mentioned, what we ideally want to do is that if we want to verify the abstract model, that we want to transfer this result also to the real system. And the real system, yeah, can never be perfectly modeled just alone by the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. But I don't want to talk too much about quantum physics. I mean, essentially, what computer scientists have looked a lot into is trace conformance, so that your abstract non-deterministic model should then be able to produce all the behaviors of a real system. And of course, with a computer program, this is possible because there's just finitely many possibilities. But with a cyber physical system, the slightest change or the slightest disturbance or sensor noise would create a next different behavior, which is not possibly captured by the abstract model. So instead, we advocate reachet conformance, where we compute a set of reachable sets of the abstract model, which then should contain the reachable set of the real system. And of course, you cannot compute the reachable set of a real system because you need a model for that. But what we can do is we can collect a lot of measurements. And if all the measurements are in the reachable set, then we say this system is reachet conformance. And you can easily prove that reachet conformance is necessary and sufficient to transfer safety properties. If you also want to transfer, let's say, fairness, then you need trace conformance, but for safety, reachet conformance is sufficient. So there are many approaches to do this. One very intuitive one would be this one. You have a nominal model of your system. And then you have the real system where some parts are not modeled and also disturbances are acting on the system. You have sensor noise, so you have deviating behavior. And then what we do is we take the nominal model as it is and inject disturbances and sensor noise such that the model error is reduced or is zero. So you can specify how much you want to reduce this. Exactly zero is impossible if you use a numerical optimization, but then we collect these added disturbances and sensor noise, and these are then added as sets, uncertain sets to the nominal model for our reachability analysis. But we have other techniques than this, but they are a little bit more complicated. As I said, this is very intuitive. So here you can see for a certain input trajectory where here we used as inputs acceleration and curvature, but you can also use steering angle. Then we injected these disturbances so that the measured output and the output of our nominal model plus injected disturbances was almost matching. And then you specify this epsilon bound, and the smaller, of course, this epsilon bound is, the longer this optimization takes. And yeah, then by adding all these uncertainties, we have now this model, which hopefully considers all behaviors of the real system. Of course, you can make this more and more reliable by adding more and more data, but there's no absolute proof in the end that this is always transferring from the model to reality, because as I said, you cannot prove physics, you can only prove using mathematics, but this would be one of the most systematic approaches to come up with models that match reality. Now, regarding the specifications, so we start with traffic rules. First we remove imprecisions. So we take the law text, and we used to work with lawyers on this actually, and then said, for instance, okay, instead of saying you should drive with a safe distance, we include a formula specifying what a safe distance means. Similar, for instance, as later on it was suggested in the what is it called again, responsibility safety system, RSS, and then you have to formalize it. So initially we used some first order logic, but now we're using, as most other teams, metric temporal logic or linear temporal or signal temporal logic. And then in some cases we also translated this to a theorem prover so that we have an provably correct monitor for this traffic rule. We didn't do this for all traffic rules because this is very time consuming, but my first PhD student was a logician, so he focused a lot on this aspect. And my second PhD student focusing on this, he was more an engineer, so he actually formalized more traffic rules but without this translation to Isabel Hall. So some examples why we have to make this more concrete, but I guess most of you also, I don't have to convince many of you because you're also experts in this area. So like if you do a lane change and you force another vehicle to slow down, then up to which deceleration should be allowed. So maybe it's 0.3 G, 0.2, 0.1. So this has to be concretized. Ideally, this becomes a European standard for traffic rules for autonomous vehicles. But as always, it's a slow process and it needs a lot of convincing that this is really required. And so if a crash happens, then whose fault is it? This is still a little bit unsolved problem. And there's similarly other problems where you don't have a dilemma, but where you have to just concretize the traffic rule. So we have now formalized all rules we're aware of for highways and all rules for intersections that we're aware of. There's still some rules we can add. So I can also, if you're interested, give you the links to these papers. As an overview, for instance, we consider rules such as road users should not damage infrastructure or other road users, or driving should be at the rightmost lane except for overtaking, or speed must be adapted to road and weather conditions, speed limits and other vehicles, or vehicle distances must be such that collisions are avoided, and braking should only be performed for safety reasons. And of course, like priority vehicles, like police vehicles or ambulances are exempt from these rules, except from Article 7, which says you cannot damage other road users or infrastructure. As I said, we have, especially in the last years, done a lot of research in this. This is just really a high level overview. So now, regarding reachability analysis, which is kind of the main technique we use for our verification. Essentially, what it does is you have a set of initial states, a set of uncertain inputs, and a set of uncertain parameters. And instead of simulating for each combination one trajectory, so here this would be a solution for one input state and two different inputs. This would be a solution for another initial set state. And all of those are not ending up in the unsafe region, but you cannot prove with simulations that all of them will be safe because they're infinitely many. So instead we compute the reachable set, which encloses all these solutions. And if the reachable set doesn't intersect the unsafe set, then you can prove that you will never enter the unsafe set. And if you want to verify, for instance, a temporal logic formula, then you would have to compute a monitor automaton and compute the synchronous product with your system. And then again, this would become a reachability problem where you don't want to end up in the unsafe state of the monitor automaton. Okay, so in reachability analysis, we can only over-approximate or under-approximate the result. For verification, you usually need over-approximation unless you compute backwards in time. So this will be, so we have different algorithms computing these over-approximated reachable sets for different system classes. So for linear systems, this works already extremely well, even for systems with more than 1,000 state variables. And the way this works is that, given this set of initial states and a set of inputs, which is split into a center and some uncertainty around the center denoted by this Minkowski sum, we first compute the homogeneous solution where we multiply the matrix exponential with the initial state and then add the convolution integral of the input solution of the center. So then we get the set, then we compute the convex hull. And then we enlarge this to account for the fact that, of course, the solutions are not straight lines between points in time, but they have certain curvature, and also to consider the uncertainty around this center input. And for nonlinear systems, again, we have several approaches, but the most simple one is to utilize the previous results. So we linearize the system, compute the reachable set of the linearized system, but as you all know, due to the linearization, a linearized dynamics is not the same as the original dynamics. So we have to add some uncertainty to account for that. So we guess the set of possible linearization errors. And then we add this using Minkowski sum to the previous computation. Then using this set, we can evaluate the Lagrangian remainder of the Taylor expansion, for instance, using interval arithmetic, and then see compute an over-approximation of the linearization errors. And if this is included in our guess, then this is a valid guess. And otherwise, we enlarge the set of guessed linearization errors. And this usually converges in one or two steps. So this is really fast. And then you very quickly get reachable sets also for large systems. For nonlinear systems, also like 500 continuous state variables are now possible with the most recent methods. So here you see, for instance, a screenshot of the ng-sim data set where we several years ago predicted what other traffic participants might be able to do. And then we've seen, okay, the real behavior was included. But of course, this can be trivially achieved by adding a lot of conservatism. But we also showed that this is rather tight. So for instance, these blue solutions are obtained by a high fidelity multi-body vehicle model and rapidly exploring random trees so that you also go into these corner cases. And the gray area shows the reachable set of a vehicle does performing this right turn. And you see that this is a rather tight computation. There are also lots of methods to parallelize these reachable set computations and to reuse reachable set computations so that it's very fast and efficient. Here, I want to also show that it's useful for collaborative driving. So one issue in collaborative driving, if you want, is that you have kind of this exponential explosion of computational complexity because the first vehicle has m possible plans, the second vehicle has m plans, the third vehicle has maybe m plans, and then of course you have m to the power of n possible plans. Of course, there are ways to mitigate this by saying, okay, the blue vehicle has the highest priority, this plans, and then the other vehicle plans based on the first plan, but then of course the solution is not optimal. So instead what we do is we over-approximate the reachable set of each traffic participant and then negotiate the areas using some polynomial auctioning mechanism so that each vehicle obtains a bubble. And of course you make sure that the bubble is big enough to have a feasible solution. And then you can optimize within your bubble. And then of course, you have just n times m possible plans. Of course, again, here you might lose some optimality, but we argue that the loss is smaller than using this priority prioritization of the different vehicles. Before I come to the videos, all our reachability approaches are implemented in Cora, except the ones for robotics and autonomous driving, because they have to be real-time capable. So we have some special tools for those. But for prototyping, Cora is an easy tool to use because it's MATLAB-based and you can easily script things. We also have this Arch workshop where every year there's a competition where all the tool developers compete against each other in a friendly competition to see who has the best tool for different types of dynamics, like hybrid dynamics or nonlinear systems or systems involving neural networks. And then, as I said, we have different specific tools for set-based prediction in road traffic, or also a new tool called SARA for prediction of humans, for human-robot collaboration. And also, we have this common road platform, which I can show if there's time in the end, where we have thousands of benchmarks for motion planning and hundreds of thousands of submissions to see which motion planning approach is best for which situation. There's also each year now a competition for motion planning in common road. Okay. Are there any questions in between? Because now I would just show some videos, or we wait until I show the videos and then you can question, ask some further questions. Okay, so then maybe I'll just show some videos. So this shows some set-based prediction, which we computed in a BMW research vehicle. So in March, we will have our own research vehicle, which we share with 10 professorships at TUM. But before that, we had to always back for some time on a research vehicle. And here you can see that the computation of these reachable sets is performed online. This, of course, seems always unsafe because these sets overlap. But in this visualization, you see the plots for the whole time horizon. So by the time that this red vehicle is there, the other vehicles are already somewhere else and there actually is no intersection. Here you see an urban scenario where you see everything coming together from the set-based prediction to the fail-safe planning to the intended plan. And you will see now the environment model of the vehicle in our common road framework. The red line shows the fail-safe plan, the black line shows the intended plan. So we just follow the intended plan for a short period of time, then fail-safe plan immediately is followed. And you see that this is safe because we have no possible intersection with other traffic participants. What is important to note is that, of course, we do not consider that other traffic participants just enter our lane, because this would be against the traffic rules. If this would happen, we would react on the fly. But as I said, we only prove that we do not cause a collision, and we will try to avoid it if possible. So first here we let the bicyclist through, and then you see that we still perform the left lane change. This is rather risky, but we intentionally kept this in the video because many people always believe that by using reachability analysis, the results are very conservative. But you see that this was tight, but still safe. This is a video showing a collaborative driving, where we first compute the reachable set, then we can negotiate these sets, and within each reachable set, we compute or plan the trajectories. Interestingly, even without the negotiation, if you just use this for a single vehicle, this can drastically accelerate your planning time. And there's one very interesting effect. The more risky the situation is, the faster this approach becomes, because you have to propagate less partial reachable sets, and then there's very, and you can extremely prune the search tree or the of the motion planner if you plan just within the reachable set. And we showed in a paper that the more risky the situation is, the faster we obtain the trajectory, which is kind of counterintuitive, but we've demonstrated this in several common road scenarios. So this is for here, this is for an intersection with where we remove the traffic light to see what would happen. And this is for a highway scenario. This is not yet optimal because this kind of lane change is unnecessary, but this was just a early demonstration that this is indeed possible. We also use our online approach for safe reinforcement learning. So here you see an example where we learned safe lane changes. And of course, if you don't have our safety layer active, there are possible collisions during training. So if this would have been trained on a, if you would have done training in a real vehicle, there would have been accidents. But with the safety layer switched on, you can still perform the training without causing any accident. And interestingly, it converges a little bit faster as a side effect because you can prune the exploration space because we already know that certain actions are unsafe. This was also applied to robotics. I always show this example because it's super intuitive. So this was a project, a very small project with Bosch, where initially they had a, it's strange that the video didn't. So somehow the video link, So this is the situation they had before. I can stop the video now. The green circles are humans approaching this blue robot, which is also actually kind of a circular robot. And when it's in the yellow area, the robot slows down. In the red area, it stops completely. So then the robot has to stop for safety reasons. But if you compute this in an online fashion using our online reachability analysis, the robot doesn't really have to stop. And the reason is really, really simple, because when the robot slows down, the time to stop is reduced. So the prediction time for the other surrounding humans is reduced. And the reachable set then shrinks. And that's why we can slip through and then don't have to stop and still are provably safe. This also shows why this conservatism that is often criticized is not really happening in reality. You can also see this in a robotic scenario. So this video also includes our research for modular robots, where you have modules. And in each module, there's information about its dynamics, kinematics, and geometry. And when you assemble these modules, the robot kind of programs itself and can be used out of the box. I mean, you still have to tell it where to go. Maybe the end effector should start here and end here, but then all the controllers and the inverse kinematics and so on is automatically obtained. And because you can always reassemble the robot to a different robot, it makes a lot of sense then to use online verification so that after reassembling the robot, it doesn't have to be recertified, but can be used as a safe robot immediately. So this shows some gravity compensation, but this is a very early prototype. This has become also a startup, and it's called Robco, and they are they have now like 40 people working there, and it's gaining a lot of traction. And yeah, here you see the online verification. It's exactly as for the autonomous vehicle. The only difference is that we compute a reachable set of humans instead of traffic participants. Of course, humans are also traffic participants, but for road applications, we don't consider the movement, for instance, of the arms as for robotics. And we see that the robot reacts quite naturally to the movement of the human. One thing that is also quite distinctive is that humans can move very fast. So, and the sensors for capturing the human posture are rather slow. So we have quite a time delay at the beginning, so that the initial set is rather large for this application. And you can see here it's safe. And if you reassemble the robot to an 8 degree of freedom robot, then it's still safe without any reprogramming. Okay, so this is the prototype that we developed in my lab before it became a startup. So this shows you the more extreme reassembly, where we split the robot into two robots so that the same task of just moving these light bulbs from one ramp to the other can be done by two robots twice as fast, because you'd only need 3 degrees of freedom for this problem. So you know it moves fast forward. Actually, the robot that's commercially available doesn't need any screwing anymore. It's like you just click it onto the robot. It's much faster. And initially it was named Kia Robotics, but the car manufacturer Kia said we are not allowed to use this name, so now it's called Robco. Okay. Good. So to wrap up, the distinctive feature of our approach is that we can compute all possible behaviors given a model, and by considering uncertain initial states, disturbances, and parameters, we can use this Richard conformance so that hopefully the real behavior is always enclosed into our non-deterministic models. And then we compute on the fly these reachable sets. And we kind of have this intrinsic safety property, because if you forget assumptions about other traffic participants, their reachable set is larger than necessary. And that makes our behavior more careful. It's like a brake in a truck. It's always on pressure. And if the pressure hose breaks, the brakes are automatically engaged. It's kind of a similar principle. And of course, accidents remain possible because of misbehaviors of others, but we verify that the ego vehicle never causes an accident with our approach. Good. So I hope I've not taken too much time, so that we still have a lot of time for discussion.
Thank you, Matthias, for the great talk. Now it's time for questions. You can either write them in the chat and I will read them for you, or you can raise your hand and I will call you and you can ask directly. So let's see, who is the icebreaker?
I will start. So I think that, you know, we left that question open in a sense. So when I ask, what happens if there is no fail-safe trajectory, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that you made the point that you're only trying to make sure that you're not responsible, right? Which is the idea behind the RSS, right? The thing is that I find that that is not really sufficient, right? So because you can imagine that if somebody runs the red light and then, then what is it? You have a license, you're free to hit them because they are wrong, because they
run. Yeah.
Not really the case, right? So also many countries have a basic rule, a fundamental rule that says that you're always under an obligation to try to avoid collisions, even in the case in which it means that you're violating the laws, right?
Yes.
So I was wondering, what is your thinking, about that?
Actually, I 100% agree. So the thing is, as I said before, even if somebody, so first of all, we constantly track the behaviors of others, and we also have a module to predict whether a certain traffic participant will violate a traffic rule. So we take this into account, but then we lose. And if somebody violates a traffic rule, we try to rescue the situation, but we cannot formally prove that we will always be able to rescue the situation. So we can only prove, yes, we will not cause an accident. And if somebody misbehaves, we try to still avoid the accident, but then we cannot prove that this is always possible, but we always try.
Right.
And we also do this prioritize using your rule book. So I have one PhD student who's working he's an external PhD student working at ZF for these shuttle services, and he's trying to incorporate your ideas in their product.
Yeah, because I think that this is something that we should make more people aware of this thing, right? Or sometimes it's not possible to behave according to all the rules. It's not possible to be completely safe, right? But there is also this notion, we have, some of our students are doing this work, so sometimes you have to crash, right? So there is no way that you can avoid the crash, the collision.
Right.
Maybe there are some collisions that are better than other, right? So how to optimally collide, right? So how to be...
Yeah, there are these papers that say they try to turn the vehicle so that it's not colliding on the side, but maybe on the front where you have more crash structures and so on. This is something we have not really researched so far, but yeah, I totally agree.
Now, another thing I was wondering is, are you using polyhedral, over approximations of the reachable set?
No, because it's they have certain computational disadvantages. So
right. So that, but I think that some of the figures, maybe more of the explanatory figures, they look like it was a lot of polyhedral approximation. So I was wondering.
Yeah. So what we usually use is for linear systems, because convexity is preserved for linear systems, we use sonotopes, because they then the overall algorithm is cubic in the number of continuous state variables. Okay. And in some cases, we have also a new paper, it's just quadratic. And there are, then you, if you combine this with some order reduction techniques, like Krylov methods, then you can go, as I said, with 5,000 or 10,000 continuous state variables. Okay. And for nonlinear systems, we have our own set representation called polynomial sonotopes, which can represent non-convex sets. And all the relevant set operations, Minkowski sum, linear map, quadratic map, intersection, convex hull, and so on, are polynomial in the dimension of the system. And if you have, for instance, a polyhedron, like there are, of course, is the half space and the vertex representation. So for the vertex representation, Minkowski sum has exponential complexity, and for the half space representation, for instance, the linear map only works if it's invertible and things like that. So they have difficulties, and there are also numerical instabilities if you convert from vertex to half space representation, which can only be avoided with infinite precision arithmetic, but that then becomes very expensive. There's, however, one very recent result which we obtained. And that was, we have found a new representation other than the vertex and half space representation for polytopes, which inherit a lot of the benefits of the other new set representations. So this is that maybe then polytopes become more interesting again.
But we have to see. What is this representation?
Sorry? So we called it a set representation. So it's like, there. It's actually, we represent. So the thing is, it's a special case of polynomial sonotope. And so the paper the first author was Niklas Kochtum, but if you're interested, I can send it to you. It's kind of fascinating that after so many decades, we found this new representation. It's very counterintuitive, but because you represent a polytope or polyhedron, I mean, the thing is like polytope and polyhedron are used, the words are used differently in different communities. So in the verification community, polyhedron is not necessarily bounded, but and a polytope has to have like vertices. So can be described always by a convex hull of vertices. But anyway, so we represent this by a polynomial, which is very counterintuitive, because with polynomials, you always assume something very smooth, but this can represent these sharp edges in a very efficient way. I can send it to you.
That's surprising. Cool. Thank you.
All right. Any other question? So there is one in the chat. I can read it. It is a more specific one. Do you have to run all rules against each situation every time, or based on predicates, Boolean evaluation model knows which rules will be evaluated at that instant?
Yeah, so we evaluate each rule all the time. The good thing is, of course, you can do this in a parallel fashion. Where we want to save computation time is that we say certain traffic participants are not relevant to evaluate certain rules. Because if you consider all the traffic participants for all the rules, then you're not real time capable anymore. But let's say for the safe distance, let's say if you have one vehicle ahead of you and then another vehicle ahead of that vehicle, if the other vehicle has a higher initial velocity and we assume the same braking capabilities, then the other vehicle ahead is not relevant anymore. Things like that. But all the rules are always evaluated. I mean, we could do this, for instance, on a highway, that we don't evaluate rules relevant. I mean, of course, the one thing we don't do is like if we're on a highway and there's no intersection, we don't evaluate intersection rules, but we always evaluate all rules relevant to highways, for instance.
Okay, Then there is a question from Dekai too, who says, I have a question about probably safe reinforcement learning, which you showed in a video. What does safe mean here? Does it mean that there is a penalty for unsafe behavior, or there is a collision check after the black box model plans the trajectory?
Yeah, right. So the thing is, like, basically the reinforcement learning agent or any system suggesting a maneuver can say anything they want, and then it goes into our verification scheme. This is then the intended plan, and we try to find a fail-safe plan. If we don't find a fail-safe plan, we execute the rest of the previous plan, and if then there's no time left, we have to execute the fail-safe plan. So that essentially we are overriding the decision of the reinforcement learning agent. And then there are different mechanisms how you can incorporate this feedback from the verifier. So either you completely override, or you try to find a compromise between the suggested behavior and the safe behavior by solving some optimization problems, so that the kind of the proposed action by this reinforcement learning agent is only altered minimally. And we can also change it in a way that it benefits the learning rate. So there's also some ideas how this can improve the learning. But the main benefit is that you can use machine learning in the real world without crashing the vehicle.
Okay.
So unfortunately, this, we have never tested this in a real vehicle. But we really want to do this with our new research vehicle. But until this is all implemented and tested, and we are sure that it's safe enough, this will take some more time.
Yes. I was saying, Dekai, if you this answers your question or not, simply follow up on the chat. Now that we have a live question from Janye Hutsu, feel free to unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah. Yeah, hello. Thanks, Professor Althoff, for your excellent presentation. And I have a question in slide 30 or 31, I think, is about. Here.
One or the next one?
Here. You said to reduce the computational complexity instead of prioritizing vehicles and let them plan trajectory one after another, you instead calculate their reachable set and prune their reachable sets so as to reduce their possible trajectories, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in the next slide, is this a kind of priority? Because why is the reachable set of red vehicle is pruned by the blue vehicle instead of another way around?
Yeah, so the negotiation is kind of some kind of auctioning process, right? So it becomes very expensive, for instance, for another vehicle to take space from another vehicle if it already has a very small region where you can safely drive.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's certain other things penalized, like how easy it is to maneuver for another vehicle. Maybe at a larger velocity, it's more difficult to do a certain maneuver and so on. So this is kind of negotiated. And then once everybody has its own bubble, they just plan within the bubble. And of course, there is some kind of, you can say that we prioritize certain things here, but it's done differently. Instead of saying, okay, you compute first, you compute second, it's all done in parallel, the computation. So we think there's a little bit more organic. And then, of course, there's some hidden prioritization in the auctioning mechanism, but we think that this result, we obtain better results. However, I have to admit that on this topic, I had just one PhD student working, and we don't have as many results as compared to maybe formalization of traffic rules. So this is still, we still think it's a very good direction, but it needs further research to see whether this is really better compared to other approaches.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, then.
By the way, that are you guys aware of our Common Road platform, or should I have quickly show this to you?
Or at least we are. We are using it. We even participated to the competition in the last symposium.
Right. There was one participant from ETH. Yes. I didn't know it actually was from your group. So yeah.
Yeah, yeah, it was. Yeah. It was.
Okay.
But I don't know, maybe the audience, I think on your webpage, you do a good job at summarizing all these tools you produce. So maybe I can link it quickly in the chat.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I mean, it's not like industry grade tool, but the idea is that we, like with autonomous driving, because it's becomes more and more mature, if you do a PhD in this topic, if you start from scratch, it's very hard to get to a point where the software is good enough that it can compete with the existing technology. So we, you know, want to enable people to start to focus on the research and not have to deal with, let's say, collision checkers or other basic algorithms.
Yeah. So I have another question. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's the last one. I don't know if somebody else has questions, but I was curious, since you mentioned while answering to Emilio that you are working also on embedding rule books into this approach, I was wondering where does the method change, or are you far enough to comment a bit about that? Or is it just preliminary work?
It can be integrated fairly easily. So let's say, and if you go back to this picture that I've shown you, where it's okay, this is explains everything in a nutshell. So sometimes you have a planned trajectory maybe which violates one rule, but this rule is minor, and otherwise you would have to crash, right? Then you say, okay, it's okay if you violate this rule, and you can on the fly say the rules that have to that we have to prove that are met is a subset of the original set of rules. So I think the interface is rather simple. So then for instance, the failsafe trajectory and the intended trajectory in the next planning cycle, if we cannot find a new maneuver and have to so what can happen, as I said, is that we have certain assumptions of other traffic participants, right? So for instance, if a person stands on the road, we don't assume that it jumps in front of the vehicle. However, if this happens, then also the previous failsafe maneuver becomes unsafe. And then we have to find a new maneuver A prime and a new failsafe maneuver B prime, but maybe there is no maneuver which satisfies all traffic rules. So then we remove traffic rules and we remove as many of the non-important ones until we have a solution. This is kind of exactly, I would say.
Okay, following the prioritization backwards, essentially starting from the least important to the.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's exactly what you guys suggested in your in your previous works, I would say.
Okay, very cool. Let's see, is there a final question? I see, Jenya, you still have your hand.
Yeah, I have another final question.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. Professor Althoff, and I think one of your research goals is to verify safety and argue that if accident rarely happens, then it's not caused by the ego vehicle but others, right? Mm-hmm. So I think your reachability-based methods could be a strong spot, but I'm thinking about, for example, if you use your method in real world traffic scenarios and you need to, for example, do you need to use some machine learning based method to, okay, there is a bicycle, there's a human, there's a bus or another car. If this is wrongly classified, how can you argue that?
Yes. So like a quick fix, of course, is if you don't have a correct classification, you can compute with both assumptions. So if you're not sure if it's a bicyclist or a pedestrian, we can predict it using the pedestrian conformant model or the bicycle conformant model. So that's an easy thing. But of course, if you what would not work if you completely miss an object, but this is almost impossible if you, for instance, have a LiDAR or radar sensors which see everything, which always reflect if there is something, even if it's a piece of paper or a newspaper crossing the road. But then, of course, you shouldn't break. The other thing is, we are also now going more in the direction, or we're going kind of up the driving stack, and also consider sensor data fusion to make it more formally correct by using set-based observers. In terms of machine learning for classification, it's quite hard to verify, especially because there's not really a formal specification. Let's say for face recognition, the specification are the labeled data, it's the labeled data set. So this is it's not really formal. But what we have some other research where we check whether when you perturb the input signal or the image with some noise, that the classification stays stable using formal methods. And in regarding scalability, now we can verify 52 by 52 pixel images, but we hope to scale it up a little bit more. So we can, if you have some 100,000 neurons, this is already possible to do this formally, but not with very large convolutional neural networks, for instance.
Yeah, okay, I got you. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. So I think we are done with questions. I want to give Matthias some time for before the next event yesterday. So thank you again very much for the talk and for the time. And good luck for the next steps.
Thanks a lot. And yeah, Emilio, I'll send you the paper on the polytoast because I think that's really cool. Okay.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you and see you all next week. Bye-bye.